Okay, so thank you very much for the invitation. So to talk here about this ultrametricity properties, I have forgotten to add here everything I'm talking about is based on some recent work of Dmitry Panchenko. So, but there is a lot of development before that, and I will explain that too. So the spline glass is a Gibbs measure with a random Hamiltonian. So and I'm just concentrating here on this Sherrington-Kirkpatrick model. So this has the Hamiltonian, I just write it down. So it is a random Hamiltonian, so the randomness is indicated in this omega here of sigma. Now I should say that the sigma has a spin state, which is just minus 1, 1 to the power n. And there I'm taking the sigma out. And that's just given by minus 1 divided by square root of n. And then some 1 ij smaller than n. And then gij of omega, so the randomness, these are random objects here, this is interaction strengths, and then sigma I, sigma j. Now you see this, now occasionally one also, but I'm leaving that out, so occasionally one is adding or subtracting an external field, but to simplify matters, I'm always sticking with this Hamiltonian here. Now I have to tell you what the G's are. So the G's are just standard Gaussians. So which are defined on the probability space. So the probability measure which is covering this interaction strength is I'm always writing with P. So that's defined on omega F and then P. So. Now you see the factor 1 in the divided by square root of n is actually the appropriate thing for a mean field type model in this context, because you see the crucial thing in all these type of models is that that the spin, say at side I, say sigma I, interacts with all the others with a total strength of order 1 here. So now because here you have this randomness here, it's not 1 divided by n as it would be for a standard mean field model. But you have to put here 1 divided by square root of n. Now you see the motivation behind Sherrington-Kirkpatrick to introduce this model, which is a mean field type model, was certainly that it had proved to be extremely difficult. You see, physically more relevant would be models with easing type models with short range random interactions, like the Edwards-Anderson model. But up to this date, the mathematical theory for these short-range spin glasses is essentially absent. So that's extremely difficult, and it's also very controversial, still discussed in physics literature, whether or not the mean field, the picture for the mean field model, is of relevance for the short-range model. On the other hand, these mean field models have proved to be very influential in other fields like theoretical computer science. So it has turned out that many models, so many problems in theoretical computer science, like the k-sat problems, and also in neural networks, like the Hopfield model, there are many models which are essentially stemming from this Sherrington-Kirkpatrick models, which have gained quite some influence in other fields. So it's not just interesting as a toy model for this for statistical physics, but it has gained quite some influence, this mean field type spin glasses. Now the point is that, okay, for the Sherrington-Kirkpatrick model, thanks to work by Talagra and many other people, Guerra, Eisenman, and recently Panchenko, is now essentially, to some degree fully understood. But other spin glass models, like for instance the perceptron or the Hopfield models, are still very far from being fully understood. So for that reason, I'm concentrating here on this Hamiltonian. Now, the first object one is typically investigating is the partition function. So So which is just given by Z and beta. Now it also depends on the randomness. If it's just the sum over the sigma x minus beta, which is h n omega sigma. And then the free energy f beta, which is given by the limit. So that's the first object of interest. So 1 divided by n times the logarithm of this partition function. So you see, in principle, this limit is not clear that this limit exists here, and if it exists, it could be random, but actually that can be excluded easily. So it's the same as if you take the expectation with respect to this randomness, which sticks into this G. So this you can add, that's what people call self-averaging. And that follows by Gaussian isoperimetry. That's not a difficult theorem. That follows by Gaussian isoperimetric inequalities here. So now the existence was first proved for all beta was in 2002 by Guerra-Antoninelli. These are not too difficult, but very tricky proof. So that's now the really first result on this free energy was obtained quite some time ago, namely that f beta equals beta square over 4 plus log 2. That was first proved by Eisenman, and I had to add here for small beta. That was first proved by Eisenman, Leibovitz, Riel. And with a similar paper, okay, at the same time by Fröhlich and Zergarinski. No, that was Landford, sorry. And Fröhlich, Zergarinski. Actually, Sherrington-Kirkpatrick originally had proposed a solution, what they got called the replica symmetric solution, which is given by a variational formula, supremum over q bigger than 0, and then beta square over 4 times 1 minus q plus the integral over log cosinus hyperbolicus beta square root of q x and integrated over the normal distribution. So plus, okay, one always has to add the log 2 here. So. And then what turns out is actually that for beta smaller or equal to 1, you easily see that the q, the infimum is, oh sorry, that the infimum, sorry. Infimum. That the infimum is attained at q equals 0. And then you get that this replica symmetric solution is just given by beta square over 4 plus log 2, the value we had above here. But for beta larger than 1, the replica symmetric solution is smaller than that here. Now what actually turns out is that for beta larger than 1, the f beta is also smaller than this replica symmetric solution. And it's given by this Parisi formula. Now, I will not state the Parisi formula at the moment. The Parisi formula is a much more complicated variational formula for this expression. I will explain it later. So I just will mention here that the first mathematical proofs were given by Guerra. I think it was 2002 or 2003, who proved the upper bound, and then by Talagrand with a very complicated proof, who proved the lower bound. And there is this recent proof by Panchenko, replacing here this Talleyrand argument, which appeared in 2013, which is relating it to ultrametricity. So, also via ultrametricity. So I have now to explain here what this ultrametricity in this context means here. So. Now you see, I also have to look at the Gibbs distribution, which is of course also the most interesting object perhaps in this context, which I write as Gn, now beta, omega, sigma. It's also a random probability distribution on this capital sigma n, and it's just given by exp minus b, and then this Hamiltonian. And then I have to normalize it with partition function, of course. Now the picture, I should tell you something, okay? The physicist's picture about this behavior of this Gibbs distribution looks like follows. For the small beta, essentially for beta smaller or equal to 1, the Gibbs distribution is not very much different from just original coin tossing. Okay, the local interaction is felt, but essentially it's just the same measure as just coming from coin tossing. But if you cross a line beta equal to 1, there is a complicated phase transition to a state where the measure is much, much more complicated structured here. That's essentially the point to understand. And the physicist's prediction was that you have a kind of ultrametric structure, hierarchical structure in this Gibbs distribution here. So. Now, on a basic mathematical formulation of this ultrametricity, looks at a certain metric on this spin configuration state and claims that in the limit it is an ultrametric here. So. Now, the point is that, of course, if you are just looking at these random variables as random variables in omega, indexed by sigma, it's just evidently a centered Gaussian field. And the covariances of this Hamiltonians is given in a very simple way. So if you're looking at the expectation of Hn sigma prime, so you take the expectation with this omega, so with respect to this Gaussian variables, it's given by n half Rn sigma prime. I will just say in a moment what that is, where Rn sigma prime is the so-called overlap. It's just the inner product, sigma I prime. Now, if you're looking I define a distance, it's not quite a distance here, which is just the L2 distance between sigma and sigma prime. Now, it's not quite a distance because you see if sigma prime is just minus sigma, you just get the same value. But anyway, divide that by square root of n, then you get 1 minus r n square sigma prime. So you just get that. Now, if d would be an ultrametric, it would mean, you see, an ultrametric is characterized that if you have, sigma prime, sigma triple prime, and you're looking, then you would have that d sigma prime is always smaller than the maximum of d sigma double prime, d sigma prime, sigma prime. Okay, that. Now, if you are looking at this, you can look at the set of this. The claim would be that under a certain measure, this is essentially close to 1, the probability. Now, the measure you have to take is that you take the product measure of the Gibbs distributions for a fixed realization of omega here. So you're just taking this Gibbs measure, so just the product measure of that and look at the probability that this is not the case. So it's a possible error of epsilon. And you finally take the expectation over the randomness. So and that should go to zero. Now that would be this ultrametricity conjecture. That is not proved. That's not a proved statement. So what is proved is okay. I will explain it. So you have to modify the situation slightly. Now, typically, I'm going back to the overlaps. I'm expressing everything in the overlaps. So then you would have you can express it by saying that sigma prime is smaller than the minimum of absolute values sigma double prime so minus epsilon. So you can, okay, then you have, would have just, I'm expressing all this now, expressing everything in terms of these overlaps here. Now, one problem here in this setup is that you would like, and actually that is also what Pachenko and other people have tried before, to look at the limit as n go to infinity, and then have a statement that the ultrametricity is exactly correct, not up to epsilon here. That should be true then for all epsilon. Yes. Now, the problem is that in these mean field models, it doesn't make sense to look at the limiting Gibbs measure, because you see the interaction is pointwise going to zero. So you don't have a limit as n goes to infinity gn. You don't know what that should mean. Now, the way out is looking, and that was not originally Panchenko's idea. That goes back to Argan, Eisenman in an earlier paper, and then worked out with Panchenko very much. Look at overlap distributions. So what you are taking is you are taking an infinite sequence of so-called replicas, so sigma 1, sigma 2, etc., an infinite sequence being in sigma n. And then you are looking at the overlap matrix Rn, I write it here, Rnij, which is just given by the overlaps you are obtaining here. So. Now that's obviously a positive, an infinite positive semi-definite matrix here. So that's positive semi-definite. Symmetric, of course. And you regard that now under the following laws. You first consider here the infinite product of the Gibbs distribution here, so which is just Gn omega, the infinite product. And, okay, that's the measure here on this infinite products of the sigma n's. But now I'm averaging finally over the measure coming from the g's. So I'm just integrating it over p d omega. So I call this the average measure. I write sk in order to distinguish it between from things I will look at it later here. So, and then you can look at the law. You can look at the law, at the distribution under this average measure of this matrix here. Now it obviously has a symmetric property because the sigma i's are chosen just in an IID fashion. So if you have a finite permutation of the indices, then you are getting the same distribution here. So this law, I call it nu n. Okay. Also, that it makes clear that it comes from Sk. So it has an invariance property. Property saying if tau from n to n is a permutation of finitely many elements. Many elements, then Rnij, this matrix, has the same, is identical in law, so given by this measure, so Rn tau I tau j. Now that's obvious here. So now I call this then, that is in literature called a Gram de Finetti. Law, so if you talk about these laws here, so probability measure. Or occasionally I just talk about this Gram de Finetti random matrix here. Now you see the point is that okay, these are probability laws, these new n's are probability measures on this space of positive semi-definite matrices, infinite matrices here. So these are probability measures. I call it m plus, so that should mean just the infinite positive semi-definite matrices here. Now on these you can talk about limits of these laws here. So that's if you have a bound, you see in our case we always have that these matrix elements are smaller or equal to one here. So and then that's a compact space, and you can talk about limit laws of these new n's as n goes to infinity. So you kind of it makes sense to talk about limit laws. As n goes to infinity. Now, despite the fact that the limit law of the gn's on the original Gibbs distributions doesn't make sense, it makes sense to have a representation of such Gram de Finetti laws in terms of a kind of a Gibbs distribution here. I'm stating that. Now, for the moment, for the next maybe 20 minutes, you can forget about SK. For 20 minutes, no SK anymore. So I will come back in the end. There is a theorem by Dovbisch Sudakov. Which states that if you have a Gram de Finetti, so any, I write it short, Gram de Finetti probability distribution on this set of matrices here, has a following representation, has a special representation. And the representation is essentially the same type of representation we had originally for finite n in terms of this Gibbs distributions here. So namely that you're taking H should be a Hilbert space, so an infinite dimensional real separable Hilbert space. It doesn't matter which one you take here. So just any, and then there exists. A random probability distribution of on H cross, there is a slight complication, so a random probability distribution on H cross the positive real axis. So there exists a random probability distribution. I also call it G on H cross R plus. Now, you see, what is a random probability distribution? So in probability theory, one typically calls it a Markov kernel from a probability space to this space H cross R plus. So that's that is a Markov kernel. From a probability space omega fp, also to this. Now this means that you just have for omega here in omegas a probability distribution on that. Here, so the randomness, you see, it's the same situation as in the spin class situation before here. So the randomness enters here into this omega here. So. And then you can define this average law in the same way as we had before. So I take now average. So now on h cross r plus to the infinite power, which is just given by average. Is the integral over these infinite products of these probability laws integrated with respect to that. So we have this situation here. Okay, now, okay, the claim of the theorem is that such an object exists in such a way that I can reproduce the law of this Gram-Definetti law in a very special way, namely just essentially through inner products of the Hilbert space. So you see, I'm just taking the mapping from H cross R plus to the power n to the matrices to m plus, where I just map a sequence here to the matrix of inner products. And then you have to do something on the diagonal, AI. So this, you take this coming from this R plus, delta IJ. So. And then the claim is, so you see, the claim is that any, I call it new here, so new is the average law of this matrix. Is the statement clear? So it's a little bit complicated to formulate, but is the statement clear? So essentially it says that any Gram-Definetti probability distribution has a representation which resembles the representation we had before, just in the case of finite n Sherrington-Kirkpatrick models. So that's the situation. Maybe I can raise now that. Next, I have to introduce the definition. A Gram-Definetti probability measure. Measure nu is said to satisfy the Guerra, Ghirlanda-Guerra identities. Provided for all n, if for all n bigger than 2, the conditional distribution, the conditional law of R1 n plus 1, so given the matrix Rn, which is the restriction to the finite first n components here. So that's just Rij. Ij is more than equal to n. Is given as 1 divided by n. It's a little bit a strange identity. You see, it essentially is just a one, okay, a mixture of the one-point measures of the matrix elements from J to n. Now, this doesn't give a full probability measure because I'm just summing over n minus 1. And the rest is just an independent sampling of the distribution of R12. So, plus, I call it 1 divided by n theta, where theta is theta of A. It's the distribution of R12. Now, this theta is then typically in the context of spin glasses called the Parisi measure. You see, it just claims that this conditional distribution, given you know the matrix up to n, if you take a new element and look at the distribution of 1n plus 1, you just either pick with probability 1 divided by n one of the matrix elements before, or you just sample it anew with the distribution of R12. Now, okay, I should add, of course, because of this Grand Affinity property with these permutations, it doesn't play a role if you have 1 or 2 or 3, or if you take here, you see, all these have of course, the same distribution here. So. Okay, now that's this Girlanda-Guerra identities. Now I should go to blackboard. This one. I can finally state the main theorem obtained by Pacheco. So I denote, okay, I'm taking this Parisi measure, assume Grand Affinity measure nu satisfies Girlanda-Guerra. And then I'm writing theta for the Parisi measure. And so the Parisi measure is just the distribution of R12. And I write Q star for the maximum of the support of the Parisi measure. Then one has three things. So the first two are rather, okay, are not very, very difficult. It says that on the diagonal, you are always at Q star, almost surely. Then you have what people call the Talagrand positivity principle, namely that the matrix elements are all bigger than zero, almost surely. So A and B, okay, it's a little bit of work, but it's not very, really difficult so to prove it. So the main statement is C, namely that you have this ultrametricity. Namely that R12 is always bigger than the minimum of R13, R23, almost surely. And then, of course, it applies to all triples of indices by this invariance properties. Now there is another theorem. Yeah, it's also in this text by Panchenko, but okay, part of it had been known before, namely that the distribution of the measure nu, this Grand Affinity measure, is uniquely in this situation, so the same as the assumptions. and then u is uniquely determined by the Parisi measure. Now, an important point is that it has a rather simple description, namely in terms of the real cascade. So remark, if the Parisi measure at the maximal point has a positive mass, okay, that one has to assume. So if C of Q star is positive, okay, if it is 1, it's trivial anyway, so I don't consider this case here. Something it's given, so nu is given through the real cascades. Now I have to describe these real cascades. So there are two ingredients. Yeah, I'm using a representation which is using a representation which is given in the paper I had written with Nipman in terms of correlation, because it's much more compact to describe it this way. So it has two ingredients. First, you are taking a Poisson point process. Is on R plus with identity measure. The measure given by lambda x minus lambda minus 1, where lambda is this 1 minus Now you see, this is what does everybody know what the Poisson point process is? It's essentially you are on the positive line, and for any infinitesimal element you flip a coin with this success probability to put the point here. So this creates a countable number of random points here. Now it turns out with this intensity measure you have countably many points and you have a maximal element, so you can order them downwards, so you get random variables countably many ordered downwards, and actually just from properties of this intensity measure you easily conclude that the sum is smaller than infinity, almost surely. So you can normalize them, xi I, sum over j, xi j. And then this xi, the collection of this xi bar, that's typically called the Poisson-Dirichlet point process. So that defines a random probability distribution on the natural number. So that's a random, because these are randoms obviously, but they sum up to 1. So they define a random probability distribution on the natural numbers. So that defines a random. On n. Okay, that's the first ingredient. So the second ingredient, actually you take that independently of 1. So it's this correlation process I had introduced with Alan Snitman. We call it gamma t. That's a continuous time Markov process on the space of partitions of n. So that's a Markov process on space of partitions. Now, a partition is of course the same as an equivalence relation here, so on the natural number. So gamma naught is trivial. So it just consists of 1 point. So just the equivalence relation equal to the equality here. So, and then the process has a property that at later time you are just clumping together from the earlier partition here. So if S is given T, then gamma S is obtained by clumping classes of gamma T. Now it has a very simple infinitesimal description. So I look at the trace on finite. You see, I'm taking a finite subset of the natural numbers. So I'm looking at gamma n of t. It's a trace on 1 divided by n. So you see, if you have a partition on the natural numbers, then of course I have a partition here on this finite set here. Now, conditioned on gamma Tn, I assume that they have capital N sets in this partition. So if gamma Tn has n by nu, classes or sets. Now, if it just has one, then of course there is no clumping anymore going on. Then it's trivial. So now if and gamma is obtained from clumping, say k bigger than 2 of these classes. Then the probability that gamma Tn is obtained in this way, conditioned on this gamma Tn, is just given by with a very simple formula, n minus 2, gamma minus 2. That's just the rate dt, or t plus dt. So plus an infinitesimal time change. So, and then you check actually that it's consistent in n. So this defines, okay, there's some work to do. So this leads to this Markov process. So you see, you're just having a continuous time, the development of clumpings together here. So. Now, for any 2 points, you can ask at which time they are clumping. So they are clumped together. So if Ej in n, that define tau ij, the increment over time, so that aj are in the same class. So if I can finally now describe finally now describe here how you produce this 1 and 2 Gram-Definetti matrix here. You see theta is given, so this Parisi measure. And I have assumed that theta of Q star is bigger than 0. So I assume. Now conditioned conditioned on 1 and 2. So you keep this object 1 and 2 fixed. You choose independent J1, J2, etc. In N, this distribution xi, this xi hat, which is coming from above. And then you are looking at e to minus tau j1, ji, jj. And you still are allowed to put an arbitrary monotone function here on it. So q from 0, 1 to c 0, q star is monotone. Now you should choose q such that I call this the matrix RAJ. I choose Q such that you match the parity measure so that R 1, 2 has law given by this parity measure. Then the Gram-Definetti measure, which is coming out from this Ponchenko theorem under the condition that you have the Guirlanda-Guerra identities and satisfy this ultrametricity properties. You see, just as a remark, by the very definition here, this is ultrametric. So because it's just coming from this hierarchical structure, coming from this clumping mechanism. But the claim is that the new, it's a distribution of this matrix R. So you see, I have to choose Q in such a way that you match the parity measure, but the whole matrix, the distribution of the whole matrix is then given by this construction. You see, it's a fairly concrete construction of this Ruel. That's not the original formulation which was given by Ruel, which is actually, okay, it would take longer to describe it. So that's it. Now, I had intended to give a little bit of indication about the proof of C, but maybe, okay, if I have time at the end, I can do that. So I think it's more interesting to see now how you can use all this structure to derive the parity formula. So that's now I first have to define what another parity formula is. So the parity formula. So just back to SK. So I write the parity formula. That's already a bit complicated. But it's actually closely related to the Ruel cascades. I cannot prove that, but I can state it. So I'm taking a parity measure. There's a finite support here. So I just take one. This is finite support because k from 0 to capital K, and then lambda k plus 1 minus lambda k delta q k, where these parameters q and lambda, okay, I'm including always 1 and 0, so 0 and 1, q k equals 1, and then lambda 0, lambda 1, up to lambda k plus 1, which I also take 1, so then taking that. And then I take k independent standard Gaussians. Gaussians, set 1, set 2, up to set capital K. And then it's a bit complicated, but there's no way out of that, xk is equal to the log cosinus hyperbolicus of beta, sum from 1 to capital K, square root of QK minus QK minus 1, ZK. And then one inductively defines from, and now I have difficulties because I cannot put this blackboard up. Okay, but then I proceed here on this side here. Smaller than K. I define XM. One defines the XM recursively down from XK. XK minus 1, XK minus 2, etc. down to X0. So it's 1 divided by lambda m plus 1 log expectation of z m plus 1 and then exp lambda m plus 1 x m plus 1. Now this means that you just integrate out the set m plus 1 here. So you just make this one-dimensional Gaussian integration here. So with that, you just here that just means integrate out the distribution of set m plus 1. So you're going down to x zeros here. So, and then you have to do it in this complicated way to write down this Parisi functional. So, which is given by this Parisi functional. Which is PK of the Parisi measure, which is just X naught minus, you can get this beta square over 4, and then some capital 1 to capital K, lambda K, QK square minus Q minus 1 square. Okay, that's just this expression, and then this big theorem. Okay, Parisi didn't have a proof, but then it was Guerra and then Talagrand at that F beta, this free energy is given by the infimum over K and this Parisi measures, so with finite support of this Parisi functional. Probably I've forgotten somewhere log 2. Probably if it, I do it in this way, I should add this log 2 here. So. Okay, now how does this relate to what we have been talking about? Here you see this is okay, if you see that, that's totally unpenetrable here. So how this comes around. Now, the point is that, in principle, okay, you just have to believe one statement about this expression here. I just wanted to have it down explicitly here. But for the rest, it's not so important that you exactly remember what was here. Unfortunately, I still have to explain you something, namely this cavity method. Method, no, that goes back to physics literature, but in the version I'm using here is Eisenmann-Zinn-Starr, introduced in this form. It is just okay. It's just the basic observation. If you look at the partition function up to n plus 1, this was just given by the sigma, of course, in sigma n plus 1. And then I have x minus beta divided by square root of n plus 1. And then sum I smaller than j n plus 1, gij sigma I sigma j, just like that. And then here you see the sigma n plus 1 just comes here at the last place, and the sigma n plus 1 you just can sum out here. So you just can write it as a sum over sigma in sigma n, and then you have x minus beta times 1 divided by square root of n plus 1 you have still here, but you sum over only up to n, g, a, j, sigma I, sigma j. And then you're just summing out the sigma n plus 1, just gives you twice logarithmus, twice cosinus hyperbolicus, times 2 cosinus hyperbolicus of beta. And then you have these so-called cavity variables. Okay, it's still 1 divided by square root of n. Sum from I equal 1 to n, g I n plus 1, sigma I. Now one important thing to observe is this is as random variables depending on the g, independent of this object, because here this n plus 1 is appearing, which is not present here. So I call that here, I'll rewrite that by z n sigma. And this Hamiltonian just, okay, that's a slightly changed Hamiltonian. This is, I call it h n prime of sigma. Now you can also write the partition function. Okay, I should fear capital N. I can also write the partition function, the Hamiltonian. You see, that's a slightly changed Hamiltonian here, so from the N system here. But I can write the original Hamiltonian in log. I can express it via this here. So you have the original Hamiltonian is in log, the same as this h n plus 1 sigma, plus 1 divided by square root of n plus 1. That's just a simple computation. Sum over I smaller than j smaller than n of g prime I sigma j, where these are just now independently chosen. Now, doing all this computation, what you are getting is, okay, I define an as the expectation of log z n plus 1 minus the expectation of log z n. So you see, I just compare here this expression with this expression here from n to n plus 1 that I can express as the expectation. Now this expectation is expectation over all these Gauss variables appearing here. So expectation of log and then twice cosinus hyperbolicus. This comes from this part here, Zn. Now this brackets with prime mean that I'm taking the expectation under the Gibbs distribution belonging to this hn prime here. So that's just a simple computation that you're getting that minus expectation over log of this Gibbs expectation of exp, there's probably a beta like in here, beta times y n sigma, where I call this, I call y n sigma. So we are just ending up with this representation. So what you are then getting is that f beta is like, it's the limit n to infinity, 1 divided by n, expectation of log Zn. That's certainly bigger or equal than the limit of this An. Okay. Now, the important observation is the following. I also remember that I've forgotten something. How much time do I still have?
5 minutes.
What?
5 minutes.
Yeah. Okay, no. Now, the important observation is now the following, is that you see these Zn sigmas and the Yn sigmas are just Gaussian random variables. And their covariance structure can be expressed in terms of the overlap matrix here. So that is so Yn sigma, Zn sigma. Can be expressed in terms of covariances. In terms of overlaps. Now, if you replace the key observation is now, if you replace this Gibbs expectation we have here with expectation under Ruel cascades belonging to the Parisi measure theta, which has finite support, which I assume to be finite support. If I'm just replacing here these Gibbs expectations with the Gibbs expectation under the Ruel cascades here, and these expectations with the corresponding random expectations for the construction of the Ruel cascades, then you see if you replace here E for the G's and the Gibbs expectations here, if you replace that by the Ruel belonging to the C, then a computation which is not totally simple but which is also not overly complicated gives you that An is exactly this Parisi functional. This gives you that An is the Parisi functional. Now that's a crucial point. Now I have forgot to tell you also that there is a crucial point with the Girland-Laguerre, because in order to apply the whole theory here of Panchenko, one of course needs that Sherrington Kirkpatrick satisfies Girland-Laguerre. So that's just then I'm essentially finished. That's the second. So Girland-Laguerre for SK. And actually that is not known if SK itself satisfies Girland-Laguerre. So that is not known and might be wrong. But it is true if you slightly perturb the Hamiltonian. So if you perturb the Hamiltonian. It is just HNSK. So maybe HN sigma. Where there as random variables, they are independent. Independent. And this, the important thing is that the variance of this is smaller than the, strictly smaller than the variances here. So the variances of HN is only small O of n. So typically just an exponent here. Now there are various results, so dating back to Guerra, Girland-Laguerre, Talagrand, so there were many results, But if you do some perturbation of that, and actually the way Panchenko has to choose is rather complicated. I will not explain it in details here. But there are various results that under this perturbed Hamiltonian, Guirlande-Aguera is approximately satisfied. Yeah, so the Gibbs distribution under this perturbation approximately satisfies Guirlande-Aguera. Now, at the same time, because the perturbation is small, it doesn't affect the free energy. So F beta is F now if you look at that, then you know that any limit law you have from this overlap distributions coming from this perturbed Hamiltonian satisfies in the limit. So any limit law of say nu n under this perturbation, as I had introduced it before, you say you take this infinite replicas and look at the overlaps, etc., and look at the distribution, satisfies Guirlande-Aguera exactly, and therefore it is ultrametric. And therefore, it is real essentially, given by the real cascades. Now, using all this together, now there is still some complicated so approximation procedures have to go on. So it still needs 20 pages to really to fill this program, to push this program through. So you conclude using the fact that. If you take real cascades in the expression we had before, you get the Parisi expression here. So the conclusion is I have no time to go into the details of all the steps you have to do. Is that the limit as n goes to infinity, n. Now, but this is really severely based on this ultrametricity business here. Is bigger than the infimum over this p dk theta. There was actually still a quite delicate point, which the whole program was not really the Panchenko was able to push this program through, but it was since a couple of years it was in the air that one could and actually Eisenman propagated that you could. You could try to argue in this way here. But there was still a quite delicate point coming from the fact that you see AN is not an expression directly in terms of the overlaps. It's only an expression in terms of expectations under Gauss measures, where the covariance structure is given by the overlap. So that's still a delicate point, which had to be settled here. But essentially, this comes out. And this replaces the telegram part of the proof of the Parisi formula. Now, unfortunately, you cannot use this type of arguments for the upper bound. So the upper bound still is using the Guerra thing. So the upper bound. Now that's not a complicated proof. Now there is a 2-3 page proof for this upper bound by Guerra, but. But the unfortunate thing is that this upper bound by Guerra is using very special properties of the Sherrington-Kirkpatrick model. So special monotonicity properties, which for instance are not satisfied for the perceptron, they are not satisfied for the Hopfield model, etc. So there are still many models where one cannot do this upper bound, type of upper bounds by the Guerra. It applies to generalizations of SK. It's called p-spin generalizations, where you have interactions between more than two spins, etc. There are some generalizations, natural generalizations, where it applies, but there are very many models, actually important models also in theoretical computer science, KZ and the perceptron from and the Hopfield model from neural networks, where this type of arguments, because everything is still relying very much on this extremely clever argument by Guerra for the upper bound here. But at least, it shows really the close connection with this ultrametricity business. One has to see that originally in the physicist arguments, starting with Parisi, Mézard, etc., this ultrametricity was always put as an input in everything. So, for instance, in this Parisi replica computation, it was always assumed that in this replica computation, you have this hierarchical structure behind. And also with this work with Mézard and Parisi, Virasoro, always this ultrametricity was put in. And I think this way Panchenko has now a mathematical proof is now clarifying this very much how to do that. Yeah, unfortunately, I didn't have time to give any indication about the proof, but I hope it gave a bit of an overview of how things were running here. So thank you very much.
Is there any hope to generalize some of this for
finite interaction? Yeah, this is, now there's a heavy code. Yeah, that this is. You have to ask any other people. So because it's very controversially discussed if this ultrametricity spin-glass picture is true for short-range models. So this is Parisi is very much on the side of people claiming that this is true, and other people too. But then, for instance, Chuck Newman and Dan Stein from Courant are always arguing, but also with non-rigorous argument that this kind of structure isn't appearing in short-range models. So for short-range models, I think it's
from a mathematical point of view, from which of those results, of course, not the full picture, cannot be generalized for short-range interaction. But do some of those results
come here? Yeah, there are no mathematical results in this direction. No, there are no mathematical results in that direction. Actually, Chuck Newman is claiming, but also with not fully rigorous arguments, that it cannot be true for short-range models. So there are some arguments which are claiming that it cannot be the case that you have this. For instance, that you have this counter. Okay, this is, I haven't talked about that, but it is essentially hidden in these real cascades, namely that you have this countably many pure states here. So Chuck Newman is always arguing that this cannot be the case. But there is no mathematical proof for that. So. Yes.
How it comes out, because you sum your sigmas are chosen according to the Gibbs measure, right?
Yeah, but the overlaps are just coming from inner products, so of this replicated. So it's just that the matrix of inner products is positive definite.
They are not exact.
Positive semi-definite.
I think the confusion comes from Parisi's paper and when he assumes that there is a constant small external magnetic field, but if there is no external field, you have the symmetry of reversing all of the spins.
Actually, that is part of the result. It's not very difficult to prove that if you have Guirlanda-Guerra, then the overlap matrix is, the elements of the overlap matrix are non-negative. That's just a mathematical result. Guirlanda-Guerra implies that. It's not very difficult. And actually Guirlanda-Guerra is probably not true exactly for Sherrington-Kirkpatrick. You also always have to do this perturbation. So and then there is a result by Talagra stating that if you do a proper perturbation of the Hamiltonian, then the overlaps are always nearly positive. So is that?
Finally, there is some gap still in the proof.
For the Sheridan particle, the metricity is not proved. So that's true. So it's only proved under perturbation. So because you need this perturbation to do Ghirlanda-Guerra, and actually the perturbation. Okay, there are many results about how to perturb. But actually, Panchenko takes a quite complicated thing because you have to mix the things together in quite an appropriated way. So he adds actually an infinite sequence of small p-spin perturbations, and then he's still doing some averaging over parameters. It's relatively complicated, but under this perturbation, one has this Talleyrand positivity. So for that, you have particularly that the overlaps are nearly also for finite n with high probability up to epsilon, nearly positive, and you have approximately Ghirlanda-Guerra. So everything has to be okay. Also, everything as explained here with this cavity method, you have in principle to do it then for the perturbation. So for the Sherrington quadratic itself, it's not proved that you have this ultrametricity conjecture. That's true. But for looking at the free energy, it doesn't matter. So because the perturbation is so small that it doesn't affect the limiting free energy. So. Yeah, does that answer your question?